Hello everybody, and welcome to another short story video. This is our fourth one, after The Riches of Roger Rabbit, Red Eyes, and The Reaper. I now present to you all, The Vindicator. So similarly to how Roger Rabbit and The Reaper kind of take place in their own separate universe that's really only made for the smaller short stories, The Vindicator will be taking place in the novel universe Red Eyes is also set in. And while we went to Palumbra here in the Dartesca region for that story, this one takes place a few years later in the Veridi region, specifically Vindicta, and across the ocean in the country of Minaces. With that in mind, I will now start the story, so sit back, relax, and listen to The Vindicator. Nerah Feridis stood idly beside her father, her white dress flowing onto the spotless floor of his throne room. There was not a speck of dust to be seen, thanks to the servants working their fingers to the bone in order to impress a man she found rather unimpressive. The only part of her father's oversized lounge she found it in herself to appreciate was the massive stained glass window that sat behind them, an ocean of colors washing over her face every time she dared to turn around. "Princess!" the king barked. "Forward!" Her eyes rolled as she obeyed yet another frivolous command, resuming her staring contest with the massive door. Between the paleness of her perfect skin and her terribly dull white surroundings, she would be nearly invisible to anyone walking through the massive metal door they were both facing, just as His Majesty liked it. Unfortunately for his royal pain in the ass, her one standout feature was her long, dark hair appearing purple when showered in the sunlight. She took a subtle step backwards, the princess once again being consumed by the everlasting rainbow as she clutched the amethyst amulet around her neck. "My lord," a servant whimpered as she creaked open the door, her wrinkled head shrinking behind the massive handle as all eyes in the room honed in on the poor woman. "What is it this time?" King Feridis sighed, motioning for the guards to stand back as she creeped through the opening. With her father distracted, Nerah found herself once again captivated by the window, stifling a gasp when she noticed another guard eyeing her from the other side of the throne. He rose his index finger to the speaker vents of his helmet, the princess resuming her calm stance as she noticed that he too was standing in the sunlight. Her eyes flickered back to the trembling servant who was now standing at the foot of the throne with two guards on either side of her.
It's the general," she spoke softly, the king frustratedly cupping a hand to his ear. "He has returned from Minaces."
"You marched all the way up here to tell me that?" he spat, a drop of drool sticking to his beard. Nerah's gaze dropped to the floor as she fought the urge to vomit.
"Well, I am wasting my time," Feridis said. "Captain, please show this creature out."
"Yes, your highness," Captain Solis said, his deep voice echoing through the chamber. The glimmer disappeared from his violet armor as he stepped toward the woman, extending his arm toward her. She took hold of him, and the pair slowly walked back toward the door. As Captain Solis reached for the door, it burst open and hit the servant, knocking her to the floor.
"Luca!" roared General Radicus as he marched toward the king with a crooked smile plastered across his stubbly face.
"Look what we got!"
Nerah looked past the large man, his metallic leg clanging across the polished floor, scuffing it up with each step he took. Two boys followed him, the dark-haired one wearing the same grin as his father. The redhead entered last, his pace noticeably slower, and his gaze pointed downward.
"General!" Feridis yelled as he formed his first grin of the day. "Is that a new helmet I see?"
"Not just any helmet, sir," Radicus exclaimed, ushering his older son forward as he presented the rusty trophy.
"Ramo, tell him how we got this."
"You wouldn't believe it, King," he shouted. "Those insurgents didn't know what hit 'em. Dad and I were swinging at 'em, and they kept running away scared."
"You do have that effect on people," Nerah piped up, a small smirk taking shape on her face.
"Damn right I do," Ramo yelled again, the princess wincing at the sound of his voice. "Everybody knows I'm a total killing machine, princess."
"So should I tell Queen Cryona that you were trying to assassinate her daughter at the last summit?"
Nerah asked, flashing a smile at him.
A slight chuckle was muttered by the other Radicus boy.
"Speak when you're spoken to, princess," King Feridis ordered, glaring at his daughter before shifting his attention back to his true pride and joy.
"No, your highness, she has a point," Captain Solis stated as he approached the group. "It seems as though the boy has committed treason."
"What?"
Ramo cried, his expression contorted into fear as he spun around, looking rapidly between the king and his guardian.
"King Feridis, I would never—"
"But it seems you did," Solis continued.
"You three were sent with a full battalion and came back alone. Did you try killing them, too?"
"Well, I—"
"Of course not," General Radicus hissed. "Those pathetic excuses for soldiers were only slowing us down."
"And what happened to them?" King Feridis inquired. "Finally, something interesting."
"Well, after we killed their commander," Radicus said, tapping the rusty helmet, "we left."
"You left an entire battalion of troops in the hands of terrorists?" Solis questioned.
"Either that or get stuck with them," Ramo said.
"How unfortunate," Feridis stated. "That is the price of war, however. You boys needed to learn this lesson sometime."
"Are you serious?" Nerah shouted at her father. All heads in the room swiveled in the direction of the princess as she stared back, panting at the realization of what she had just done. Never had the princess raised her voice to the king, or anyone for that matter. She didn't know what had gotten into her, but she liked how it felt.
"You dare speak to me like that?" Feridis growled. "In my own throne room?"
"Yeah, I do," Nerah told him, clutching her amulet again. "You cowards left hundreds of soldiers to die, and you're playing it off as the price of war?"
"Well, what do you suppose we do, princess?" Rimmo spat back venomously.
"You're gonna stop calling me princess, that's for damn sure," Nerah ordered, stepping in front of the king and his subordinates.
"Renouncing the throne, are we?" Rimmo teased. "Fine by me. I think I'd make a pretty good..."
"No," Nerah said. "But I am taking command of you three, so you'd better start calling me ma'am."
"You can't do that," Rimmo cried, looking at the king with wide eyes. "She can't do that, can she?"
"No, she can't," Feridis stated, motioning toward Solas. "Captain, please take the princess back to her quarters and keep her there until she learns some respect."
"As you wish," Solas replied, ushering the princess out of the throne room.
The door shut behind them, drowning out the rest of the newest Radicus battle brag as the pair continued down the bright corridors of Castle Vindicta. They soon reached Nerah's room, where Solas came to a halt.
"Well, your highness, it appears my task has been completed."
Nerah nodded her head sullenly before reaching the door, but Solas's hand beat her to the handle.
"It has just occurred to me that you are the highest-ranking member of the Viridian court in my presence," Solon said, the princess cocking a confused eyebrow at the armored man. "If you were to give me an order, I would be obliged to see it through."
"I suppose you would," Nerah said as a mischievous glint formed in her eyes.
"Notify the Vindicators. We're going to Minaces."
"Listen up, men," Nerah barked at the line of white-armored knights lined up on the top deck of the airship. She could see the faint speck that was Castle Vindicta through a window behind the soldiers as the Justifier flew beyond the mountains surrounding Viridi's capital, wondering what the consequences for commandeering her father's prized vessel would be. She ultimately decided it didn't matter, given the stakes of their mission. "You're all putting yourselves at risk for joining me, not because of what lies across the ocean, but of what awaits us once we return. Nevertheless, your fellow soldiers have been left at risk, and we are the only ones who can bring them to safety. Our people need us, so I need your attention to be on the mission. We can worry about King Feridis later."
"Not to worry, your highness," Captain Cross assured her. He was a young and eager soldier who hadn't seen much action outside of a few local riots, but she simply couldn't deny his spirit. "We're loyal to you, just as you are to us. We'll get him back, won't we, boys?"
"Yes, sir,"
the others cheered. Nerah smiled, her heart warming at the sight of her soldiers, her friends, and their willingness to stand up for their people. It only sank when she realized how many of them might not return home. She found herself toying with the amulet again, the spirit of these men reminding her of someone long gone.
"You've trained them well, your highness," Solas commented from behind her.
"You mean you trained them well," she told him. "You taught us everything we know. Well, you in the academy."
"I'm not talking about their skill in combat, Nerah," he replied. "You've trained their morality. You and I both know courage and compassion is uncommon in our culture, to say the least."
"That's because we learn from outsiders, like you," Nerah said, still holding the jewel of her purple amulet.
"Like my mother."
"She'd be proud," Solas said. "She was never one to listen to your father, either."
"But you are," she insisted.
"Why did you come along? This could cost you your position."
"There are more important things in life than titles, my dear," he assured her. "Besides, it is my duty to protect the royal family. I wouldn't be a very effective member of the king's guard if I let his daughter run amok, would I?"
"It's nice you think that, Cap," one of the other soldiers remarked, marching toward them with another few steps behind them, his head tilted toward the floor. "Because you'd better get used to life without him."
"And you had better get used to obeying your princess, boy," Solas told the soldier, his deep voice somehow lowering to a distinct growl.
The captain was almost never mad, but one of her favorite things about him was that he had no patience for the antics of the Radicus family.
"Obey her?" Rimmo yelled, throwing his helmet off. "You snuck onto the king's flagship to go on a secret mission."
"Didn't we also do that?" his brother asked, gently lifting his own helmet off as Rimmo sputtered in search of a response. For the first time in his life, Viridi's golden boy had found himself speechless.
"Well, it was your idea, smart guy," Rimmo cried. "There goes my shot at the throne."
"It's not even your—" Nerah started before realizing it wasn't worth the effort.
"What do you think you're doing here?"
Well, princess," the red-headed boy began. "Personally, I thought you made some very good points back there, and—"
"He wanted to impress you by getting those no-good duds out of Minaces," Rimmo finished.
"If you wanted to impress me, you wouldn't have left them there in the first place," Nerah told the pair. Rimmo's brother shrank behind him as he continued to glare at the princess.
"Well, I don't really care, princess. I just want to see you behind bars," Rimmo exclaimed.
Nerah marched right up to him, unholstering a pistol and pointing the barrel at the boy's chest. In addition to being armed, the princess had also cut her dress to knee length and suited up in a set of white armor the captain had specially made for her during their training sessions. She was prepared to kill anyone who stood in the way of her people's safety, and Rimmo Radicus was no exception.
I think you've forgotten who you serve, boy, Nerah growled at him, his face now as white as his armor. You report to the Veridian throne, and despite what your sense of entitlement tells you, I'm going to be the one sitting on it. Now, you can either keep being my father's little errand boy, or you can be the person our country thinks you are and be a goddamn hero. So, which of these guys do you want to be?
My apologies, princess, Ramo stuttered, his eyes focused on the pistol that continued to rest against his chest plate. How can I be of service?
Stop calling me princess, she ordered, and for the love of Luxura, grow a pair, will you? Nerah Feridis could not believe her eyes as she stepped off the Justifier. She had spent her whole life surrounded by the comforting grasslands of Veridi and the confining stone walls of its castle, and was taken aback by the crimson cliffs of Minaces. As her feet sank into the red sand, the princess realized just how much she had to learn about the world.
"This is where you've been fighting the war?" Nerah asked as the Radicus boys flanked her.
"It's nothing like home, that's for sure," the younger one said, his gaze fully pointing upward.
"The name's Ronnie, by the way."
"Ronnie," Nerah repeated.
"Have I ever told you that you're my favorite, Radicus?"
"Really?" Ronnie asked, his face lighting up like their armor beneath the blazing sun.
"Why?"
"Because you keep your mouth shut," she winked at him.
"Smooth," Ramo teased.
"I'm still her favorite," Ronnie replied with a smile. "Maybe I'll be the king someday."
"Only in your wildest dreams, boy," Captain Silas said as he descended the stairs behind them. "Now, do us a favor and try not to upset her. She's just as familiar with rule number one as you are."
"What's rule one again?" Ramo asked.
"Do not hesitate," Ronnie answered, the color draining from his face.
"Oh." The Vindicators weaved through the narrow canyons of northern Minaces for what felt like hours, although with the sun staying perfectly in place, there was no way to tell how much time had passed.
"I don't get it," Ramo whined, aimlessly swinging his sword around to keep himself minimally entertained. "We have a flying freaking airship! Why are we walking through these stupid canyons when we could just fly to the prison?"
"Because then they'd see us, you dolt," Nerah answered. "How did you guys take down that cell with this simpleton in charge?"
"Brute force, mostly," Ronnie replied.
"We lost several smaller ships, but Dad's made it through."
"Let me guess," Nerah said. "You brought up the rear?"
Ronnie looked down again, this time in shame. It was truly a wonder those two were still alive, much less celebrated. Nerah looked to Solas for his advice on whiny children when she realized he wasn't there, and stopped the group in its tracks.
"Where's Captain Solas?"
"My apologies, Your Highness," he spoke up from behind the group. She watched him trudge to the front, obviously tired.
"Legs giving out, old man?" Ramo chuckled, swallowing the rest of his laugh when he spotted Nerah reach for her gun again.
"Captain, are you all right?" Nerah asked him.
Yes, I'm fine," Solas assured her before tapping his helmet. "It's just a little hot under this thing. I'm not exactly used to this much sunlight."
"Why don't you take it off, then?" Ramo piped up again, still swinging his sword around.
Ronnie elbowed him in the ribs, and the boy shut his trap.
"Better to boil than burn," the captain replied. "I'll be fine."
The group marched on, despite Nera's protests. Captain Solas was just as stubborn as he was loyal, and she knew he would rather die than wait for her to come back. If that would be the case, she didn't want to ignore the man.
"Where is it you're from again?" Nerah asked, looking up at her mentor.
"Up north," Solas replied, his eyes trained on the path ahead of them. "Plenty of snow, not much sun."
"You know, as many times as we've met the Teskins, I've never actually seen their kingdom," Nerah said. "I've never seen much of anything, I guess."
"Then allow me to share with you a piece of my culture," the captain said, unsheathing a curved blue blade from his belt. "This is what we call a cryoblade. It can cut through just about any material, not with heat, but lack thereof. Watch." In one swift motion, Solas cut Ramo's sword in half with the cryoblade, Ramo staring at the stub of his weapon as the ice-covered tip hit the ground.
"What the hell, man?" he cried.
"Holy," Nerah began, at a loss for words. "I've never seen the Teskins wield anything like that. Where'd you get it?" "I crafted it myself," he said, retracting the blade into a dagger before sheathing it again.
"Hey, doesn't Dad have a few of those retractable things?" Ronnie asked. "He says one of those took his leg off."
"Yeah, the Nightmare King," Ramo exclaimed, grabbing another soldier sword. "His head would be the ultimate prize."
"You can't honestly tell me you believe in that garbage," Nerah said, rolling her eyes as she faced forward again. "I hear enough about the shadow monsters from my father. He sounds like a scared little kid."
"Then how do you explain Dad's leg?" Ramo challenged her.
"Probably lost it on one of your suicide missions," Nerah said before halting the group at an opening. "We're here." The group peeked through the opening to see a clearing amongst the crags with several tents dotting the area and a group of men in chains being led into a dark tunnel. "Those must be the survivors," Ronnie stated, looking over to Nerah. "What are your orders?"
"Wait, you're actually going to do what I say?" she asked.
"Oh, he'll do anything for you, princess," Ramo teased. "Rule one," Solas reminded him.
"Sorry, commander."
"Here's what we're going to do," Nerah said, facing the group. "Cross, you and your men will create a diversion by firing on the insurgents from these cliff openings. It's a labyrinth in here, so they should have some trouble finding you for a bit. I'll take Solas and the airheads into the mine and get the survivors."
"Why do we have to go with you?" Ramo whined.
"And why are we the airheads?" Ronnie inquired.
"Because you're apparently self-aware, and you owe those men an apology," Nerah barked as she unholstered her pistols. "Any more gripes?"
"No, ma'am," Cross and the other Vindicator shouted.
Then let's go save the goddamn day, Nerah ordered. The Vindicators weaved through the canyons, and once the barrage of plasma bolts erupted, Nerah led the others toward the mine. As the insurgents returned fire, Ramo jumped in and began cutting down soldiers in a frenzy. A man in Ramo's blind spot took aim and fired, narrowly missing as Ronnie pulled his brother out of the fray.
"What are you doing, man?"
Ramo yelled as he defended against another man's sword.
"Saving your life again," his brother shot back, firing arrows from a metallic bow. Each one glowed a bright blue as it whizzed through the air, colliding with a target.
Nerah didn't think the boy actually had it in him to hit anything.
"Watch out!"
Ronnie raised his bow up to block another sword strike that nearly took Ramo's head off. As both men closed in on the brothers, Nerah fired off a blast from each pistol that pierced the men's skulls and sent them crumpling to the scorched sand beneath their feet. The boys looked at her, stunned.
"It's not like I expected much from you either," she told them. "Come on, we gotta get the prisoners."
"She's so hot," Ronnie gushed.
"Now? Really?" his brother asked.
"What?" Ronnie cried as the beads of sweat formed on his face, which now matched the sandy cliffs around them.
"It's the sun. It's pretty high up there."
"Just stop," Ramo insisted, turning around and walking straight into Nerah. Both boys' faces were now redder than the roses her self-absorbed suitors offered her every year.
"One mission at a time, gentlemen," she said.
"Yes, ma'am," the brothers shouted, running into the mine.
"For the love of Luxor, please only do the first one," Nerah muttered as she ran after them.
The trio entered the mine to discover several corpses scattered throughout the tunnel, each with an ice-coated sword wound.
"Where are that guy's eyes?" Ronnie shrieked. "What the hell are you—"
"Your Highness!" Solas shouted from deep within the mine. "I could use your help, if you don't mind." The trio ran past dozens of fallen insurgents before finding the captain in a large room, his cryoblade embedded in a dying man's stomach as the ice crept outward from the wound. He retracted the blade, letting the man fall before turning to his comrades. Nerah looked past him to see a group of Viridian soldiers with three insurgents behind them, each pointing a handgun at the back of a different man's head.
"What, too afraid to shoot at an armed man?" Ramo challenged them.
One man raised his gun to Ramo, who held his arms in the air with no weapons in either one. The man fired a plasma bolt, to which a surprised Ramo tried to avoid too late. The bolt hit his left shoulder, knocking him down as he howled in pain.
"Your aim sucks! What the hell was that?"
Nerah yelled as she swatted him on the head.
"You almost got yourself killed! Their bullets can't break our armor," he cried.
"Then why are you on the floor?" Nerah questioned him. "Looks like they got a hold of the good stuff," Ronnie stated as he drew an arrow, twisting the tip so it began glowing red. "They've adapted. Now it's our turn." The men tightened their grip on their guns as Ronnie fired his bow, but the arrow flew above them, causing them to laugh. Nerah couldn't help but facepalm, but through her fingers she could see the boy smirking. She quickly looked up to see an arrow collide with the ceiling, causing a large explosion overhead. The three men looked up to see rocks falling toward them, and Nerah took the opportunity to shoot two of the men while Solas pulled the prisoners back toward the tunnel. The man who'd shot Ramo looked back down to find no prisoners, his gaze meeting Nera's for a split second before the cave collapsed in on him. She felt herself get pulled back into the tunnel, Ronnie's grip tight on her forearm. They were back outside in a flash, coughing from the dust of the cave-in.
"Sorry, ma'am," Ronnie said as he let go of her arm.
"No, it's all right, actually," Nerah said as she flashed a smile at him that was met by the goofiest grin she had ever seen.
"Thank you, Ronnie."
"You said it yourself. We serve the throne," Ronnie said, panting as he saluted her.
"Please don't do that."
"Yes, ma'am."
"Also, maybe you could just use my name, all right?"
Nerah asked. The boy nodded his head, and their eyes both flickered back to the cave as the dust cleared.
"Did you even have a plan after you shot that arrow?"
"I figured you'd know what to do," Ronnie assured her. "Maybe you do have the Radicus recklessness after all."
"Yeah, it'd be nice if we had someone to keep us in check," Ronnie said, still smiling at her.
"Don't get any ideas," Nerah warned him. "We still have to face my father."
"Did you really think you'd get away with this?" King Feridis scolded his daughter.
The group had made it back to the Justifier with almost no casualties, and all six prisoners Nerah and the others had rescued, along with several more found within the mining camp by the rest of the Vindicators. Nerah had entered the throne room, her once white dress stained red with blood and sand. She now stood before the king, prepared for whatever punishment he would dole out. It couldn't be any worse than standing beside his throne all day, could it?
"If I may interject, my lord," Captain Solas interrupted, "it was I who encouraged her to go on this mission. I did not follow through on my assignment, and so I request that Her Majesty's punishment be directed at me instead."
"He delivered me to my quarters just as you ordered him to," Nerah shouted, her plea echoing through the massive throne room. "I gave him the order to help me save those men, so he should not be punished in the slightest."
"Both of you are guilty of treason," Feridis shouted. "General, if it wasn't for your boys, these two would have surely gotten themselves killed."
"Actually, Your Majesty," Ronnie interjected, much to the king's surprise, "Nerah saved both our lives, and I'm not sure anyone would have made it out without the captain."
"What is your point, Ronnie?" General Radicus inquired.
"Well, sir," the boy stuttered, finally looking the king and his general in the eye, "I think you should give them more credit, and maybe let Nerah come along with us next time?"
"Roy, he can't be serious," Feridis whispered to the general.
"I don't know, Luca. She did rescue those guys," Radicus responded.
"I mean, look at who her parents are. You can't be that surprised, can you?"
"I gotta go with Dad on this one," Ramo added. She knows what she's doing, and admittedly, she did kind of save us. Which, I'm sure, is something your father is fully capable of doing, Feridis desperately exclaimed.
Luca, we need her, Radicus said, tapping his metal foot against the floor. King Feridis gulped and sighed in defeat. He looked back at his daughter, her eyes hopeful for a meaningful future.
I just want to protect Veridi, Nerah pleaded, staring up at her father with tears forming in her eyes. I just wanted to make you proud.
Very well.
Yes, thank you, Nerah cried, a large smile spreading across her face. You won't regret this.
I better not, Feridis stated as his daughter ran out of the room, the Radicus boys following her.
I didn't know you cared so much about your father's approval, Ronnie said. You know, mine favors Ramo so much, I kinda wish I— Are you kidding me? Nerah laughed. I don't give a damn what his royal hiney thinks about me. I just need him off my back next time we go out ass-kicking together.
Damn, princess, I didn't know you had it in you, Ramo said with an impressed smirk.
I guess you're stuck with us now, huh?
Don't get too excited, she said.
So, boys, where to first?
Alright, everybody, that was The Vindicator, the origin story for the Princess of Veridi and a glimpse into what's happening on the other side of the world from the Red Eyes story. So now we know what the humans are up to, what the Nishans are up to, and yeah, we have a couple of good prequels for the novel series. I hope that you guys enjoyed, and if you have any feedback or comments or anything you'd like to say, please leave a comment down below because it really helps me out as a writer. But that is it for today, and I will see you all another day. Goodbye!